Surge protectors have nothing to do with lightning. It has everything to do with surges. So a lot of times I will get customers that call and they're like, hey, my house is, you know, after the last storm is like acting crazy. Can we put a surge protector in? Or they'll say, hey, I want some lightning protection. Can you put one of those like surgy things in the panel? And I've even seen electricians sell these as a way to mitigate lightning damage. So I wanted to talk a little bit about what surge protectors are and what they are definitely not. What they are definitely not is lightning protection. If lightning were to hit this, we're talking like a billion joules worth of energy from the sky to Earth. Nothing's going to protect anything, right? Like a direct strike. Lightning protection systems are specifically designed systems that have rods and metal structures and that have ground wires that go down into the Earth with multiple different ground rods. It's meant to actually take a direct strike, give a path for all of that energy to bypass the entire house and make it into Earth. That is a lightning protection system. But a small little device like this put inside of a panel that's got little electronics in it is not meant to handle that direct energy. What it is meant to do is protect against surges. So what I have in front of me are two different types of surge protectors. These are both ABB brand. This is the THQL Surge 2. It's a single phase surge protector that gives 25,000 amperes of protection. Surge protection. This is the OVRHT3D. This is a three-phase surge protector. So a lot of you out there are used to putting these in homes and residences, but many of you may not know that there are three-phase surge protectors. And you'll notice each one of the three phases, the neutral and the ground, all have a wire going into them. This is one style of a surge protector where it's like an under panel mount. You have a knockout, you knock it out, and then you thread it in and it just sits there exterior to the panel. But there's also some that go directly into the panels. So this snaps in just like a normal breaker would. You see the backside of it, it looks like a breaker. Hooks in just like a breaker would, but it does come with a neutral pigtail. This one doesn't have any wires and this one does. They're both type 1 devices. So for surge protection, you're either gonna have type 1, type 2, type 3, or type 4 surge protectors. Mostly for electricians, when we're doing whole home surge protection, we're dealing with type 1. And type 1 just means that there's already inside of the device some type of overcurrent protection. They don't actually need to have a breaker. In this case, I just installed a breaker because I needed something to hook it up to, but you can actually hook these up to lugs on the line side of the panel because they don't need overcurrent protection. But what you want to be really careful for is when you're putting wires in, you want as little lead length as possible. So from the manufacturer, they've got like a certain set of leads. You don't want to extend that and make them even longer because you're adding more impedance, which is a bad thing. So you want a low impedance path as much as possible on all of these conductors. And it really just has to do with the delay that happens for the surge protection to happen. So it's a function of time. The longer lead length that you have, the more that there's like a slight delay for it to be able to be effective at doing what it's doing. So the least amount of impedance possible, the better. But what's going to happen with a surge protector is it's gonna take any kind of excess energy that comes into the system and it's gonna dampen it. And it's gonna take any of the excess energy and try to dump it to Earth. So there's a little mechanism inside here, which we will get into in a second, that allows for all of that energy to be shunted. You can kind of think of shunting as like something's supposed to be going this way, but you're shunting it over that way. You're like choosing to put it into a different path. And usually that path is ground. A type 2 device, some of these will look very similar, but type 2 devices actually have to have a breaker because they do not have their own overcurrent protection inside of them. There's also type 3 devices and type 4 devices. Type 3 are more like the plug-in. You might have some kind of a plug strip or UPS or something like that that'll have surge protection in it, and it's meant for a very specific piece of equipment. And then type 4 are anything that's inside of a piece of equipment. So you're like a wash machine or something like that. If you get some high dollar wash machine, it'll probably have some inherent, like a type 4 surge protection device. And usually that's not something we mess with. That's something that whoever manufactured that equipment will deal with. Now I put a third surge protector in here. So ABV actually has a few different options. This T-Home Surge looks a lot like the OVRH T3D that I did in the three-phase environment. Both of these are externally mountable. They're both type one. So they already have some kind of inherent overcurrent protection in them. So they don't really need protection by a breaker, but they have leads. So if you wanted to hook them up to a breaker, you can do that. If you get the THQL Surge 2, this snaps inside of a panel. So you really just have to think about, like, when you're buying a surge protector, do you have an application where you actually want to have this externally mountable so that you can see the light with the panel closed? Then you have lead length that you have to think about and try to make them as short as possible. Or do you want something that just snaps in place? They're both great options. The one cool thing to note about ABB, for those of you who didn't know, ABB just recently bought all of GE's lines of residential breakers and panels. So all of these kind of look like GE breakers because they used to be. And nowadays, if you're gonna, you know, look for a replacement for the GE breakers that you need for some specific job you're on, look to ABB. They just have ABB's branding on them and their engineering behind them now. But another really cool thing about these breakers is that they are listed to have two conductors in the terminals. That's key. A lot of brands out there, you're supposed to have one breaker, you put one wire in it, screw it down. That's all it's listed for. But these are actually listed to have two. So you could still utilize this 20 amp breaker for whatever loads you have out, you know, motor, whatever you've got, but you can also tap a second set of conductors inside of it and you're not violating any code. So using this, a lot of people are like, ah, crap, I have to use up another space. I have to add a breaker in for this thing. You don't actually have to. These things, as long as you're on a 20 amp or 30 amp two pole breaker, you can pop these things into any of the ABB THQL style breakers. So what is a surge? A surge is basically just some rapid change of voltage. In the National Electrical Code in Article 242, 2023 National Electrical Code, we call it overvoltage protection, right? We call breakers overcurrent protection because they need to monitor how much current is going through and they need to do something about it. But with a surge protection device, it's monitoring voltage and it's trying to make sure if there's too much voltage, specifically like a sudden spike, it needs to cut that off. So there's a couple of different ways a spike or a transient or an overvoltage might happen. A spike is something that you just have this quick instantaneous event. It's like very, very fast. There's also what some people call ringtail waves, where it's more like a damping oscillation. So like in physics, when you have something that's oscillating, if you damp it, you actually create the, or like force the oscillation to stop really quickly. So that's a different type, but it's also just a instantaneous, like really, really fast thing that happens. So transient, you're going to hear this word. My whole career I was hearing transient, and like years and years went by and I just never knew what that word meant. Transient just means a short burst or spike of voltage. So what causes transients? There's internal and external transients. There's things inside your home that, you know, if a motor kicks on or if like you start welding all of a sudden, a instantaneous change is going to happen and it's going to create a surge or a transient. Usually the internal stuff's not big enough to kick those surge protectors to make them have to shunt power down to earth. These are generally a lot smaller, but you could have things that happen. You could have harmonics, and the additive nature of harmonics could raise voltage levels up. So you might be able to trip something. I keep saying trip like it's a breaker. I'm talking about tripping the surge protector into shunting power. But generally, like indoor loads, you're going to be talking about motor starting and stopping, any switching of inductive loads, switching of capacitive loads, electronic equipment, things like that, any welding equipment. Those will actually surge your entire electrical system, but they derive from in the home. Then you have external surges. So things like lightning strikes on the nearby utility lines, not direct lightning strikes. That's a whole different thing. These things will not protect against lightning. If your house gets hit by lightning and you have a surge protector, and you try to call about the warranty, like it didn't protect, it's like, yeah, dude, there's like millions of volts, right? Like 100,000 amps is way more than these things are rated for because these are not lightning protection devices. So if lightning here hits like nearby though, it could hit something on the utility, it could hit nearby utility, and that voltage gradient in the ground now is gonna create a transient on the lines. And so you could get a surge of transient energy through the lines that way. Any kind of utility line switching. So, you know, if the power company like connects or disconnects power, that instantaneous change all of a sudden could surge the entire system. Capacitor bank switching, so a lot of utilities use huge capacitors for power factor correction. If there's a lot of inductive properties and you know, motorized loads and things in an area, they might have to put capacitors in to try to keep things back in balance with their power factor. But the switching on and off of those, any kind of clearing faults or load shedding too, like load shedding is like choosing to shut certain loads off. So anything like that, like a turning on, turning off, basically in those moments, just like if we have a motor and we turn a motor on and there's a bunch of inrush current all of a sudden, we can also have a similar thing with voltage. So surge protection, you need to understand that it is over voltage protection. It is not lightning protection. We call it over voltage protection. We've created codes about it being over voltage protection. It is a function of voltage and it has nothing to do with lightning. Think about this. If we've got a cloud, if you couldn't tell, we got a cloud and we got lightning that comes down and hits a house. You're gonna have potentially 100 million volts in a direct strike down to earth. 100,000 amperes of current, like these numbers are wicked loose too. You could have 300,000, you know, it's all over the place. But I'm just like roundabout why a surge protector is not gonna work is because there's hundreds of thousands of amps going through at 100 million volts, 300 million volts, but you could have 100,000 hertz of frequency because you still have this electromagnetic wave of energy that is not steady state in any way. It's like kind of chaotic and random. So there is an oscillatory nature to that. So you're still gonna have a really, really high frequency event. And then you're sending a billion joules of energy from the sky to the earth. This little device, not a single one of these can handle a billion joules of energy going through it. Usually they will have a joule rating on them and it's more about like the longevity, the lifetime of a surge protector and how many joules it can handle over time before it stops functioning, but it ain't nowhere near a billion. So the ratings for surge protectors, what they are rated for, you're gonna have a system voltage. Everything in red here is pertains to voltage E. Everything down here, blue is I current. So for voltage, you're gonna have a system voltage. It's gonna tell you which systems it'll work on. So 120, 240 for like a single phase system. And then for three phase, you might have like 120, 208. You're gonna have this thing called MCOV, which is the max continuous operating voltage. And with the one that I have specifically here, the Surge 2, it's 150 volts line to neutral or 300 volts line to line. And that's saying that this is the voltage, this is basically the clamping voltage, that if we exceed this voltage, this thing's gonna start functioning. It's gonna start to try to shunt energy down to earth because it's too much, it's in excess of this MCOV rating. Then we have another rating, VPR, which is the voltage protection rating. And a VPR is basically, what are we trying to take whatever this crazy voltage is down and clamp it down to? So that the effect of this is that we're reducing the voltage, cutting the peaks off of this thing and getting down to like a safer, stable voltage. And that's what your VPR is. And so as long as, you know, like if it'll detect anything like line to line, maybe over 300 volts, but it'll clamp everything down below 1,000 volts. It's not gonna let it go above that. So you might have something that's like 20,000 volts all of a sudden, and it will clamp because holy crap, that's a huge amount of voltage, but it's gonna try to reduce it down below 1,000 volts at the end of the day. Now for current, you're typically gonna have like a big number and a smaller number. You'll have a continuous current. So like IN on this device says 10,000 amps, and it just means that like, kind of as sustained over and over, 10,000 amps is the amount of current that it can handle for it to continue functioning, you know, over and over and over. But the single maximum amount of current that it can handle is 25,000 amps. So with a surge protector, you don't buy them just to be able to take one hit. Ideally, you want the device to keep functioning over and over and over. And most of the surges that you're gonna get are not gonna be this crazy. Line surges, things like that, you might be talking like 1,000 volts or something like that. So these things are actually meant to last. They're meant to be used over and over and over and over. And they've got a light on them. So typically if the light works, you're good. And the light stops working, got to get a new one, right? That's the indicator that it gives us to know if they're good or bad. So how do they work? There's a thing on the inside of a surge protector that is called an MOV or a MOV. It's a metal oxide varistor, and a varistor just means a variable resistor, varistor. So how it's constructed is there's two wires that go to these two plates, kind of like a capacitor, really. And then there's a metal oxide grain, which you can kind of think of this whole thing as a capacitor, but you could also think of it as a resistor because this metal oxide grain in here is actually somewhat conductive. So this thing starts out having a high amount of resistance, like a huge amount of resistance, so that you're not going to be conducting through it. But if you start to raise the voltage, there's almost like a let through voltage at a certain point where this thing becomes very conductive. And so it's variable and it's resisting, but it can kind of also act like a capacitor because you could kind of think up to at a certain level that this is a sort of dielectric in between two plates and a capacitor. Now, the reason that I'm telling you that is because if you were to look on a graph of like how this works, you're gonna have a certain voltage down here, and as voltage increases, we're gonna get to a certain point where this thing activates. And the amount of current that's gonna be able to traverse through it, because it is a resistor, you're gonna have some like small infinitesimal amount of current that's able to go through it just because it's a resistor. It's not infinitely resistive. Or it would be a capacitor. It would just be a capacitor, right? So current will start to go up too. So once we get to this let through voltage, a massive amount of current will go through, and that's how it's designed to work. Now, where these things are hooked up in a circuit matters. So let's say we've got a circuit here. We got line one, line two, and neutral. This is a single phase environment. This is the circuit or the loads that we want protected. What we can do is from line to line, we can put one of those MOVs in. And that ensures that if you all of a sudden have this spike of voltage and you have a huge difference of potential between L1 and L2, this thing will act to kind of mediate that and bring it back down to a more stable level. So it's not necessarily shunting anything to earth. It's trying to balance those voltages back out on the two lines between line one, line two. But if you wanted to go line one to neutral or line two to neutral, you can also run MOVs between line and neutral, between line and ground. And that's where if you had that same transient, you could send the excess energy down to earth. I say you could, like you have a choice in the matter. The main thing is these things are designed to take any kind of excess energy that can't be handled in the system. And rather than bouncing that energy around and oscillating into your TV, your computer, and all of your sensitive electronics, and it just oscillating and like destroying everything. It's energy, right? It's invisible energy. It's meant to dissipate any of that energy back down into Earth because Earth can handle that. So that's the goal with a surge protector. And that's why we have to ground these. That's why, you know, most of them come with like a neutral connection, even if they don't come with wires. If they do come with wires, they typically come with all the hots you need and the neutral and the ground. But the intent is to try to dampen and dissipate any excess energy in the electrical system. Now, some other things that might be in one of these are things like inductors, chokes, high frequency capacitors. So some of the functionality in some of the designs is also to filter out unwanted frequencies. So you might have high frequency events that happen through a surge, and there are other components that can assist with that beyond just the MOV. So that's pretty much it. I just really want to stress the importance of understanding that these are not going to protect anybody against lightning. You need to be careful about what you're telling customers that it's going to protect, and then in educating them about the warranty process if something does happen, how to go through that warranty process. If a home is directly hit by lightning, you have to tell your customers this. This is not going to do anything. This is going to probably blow up. And so will everything else, your TVs and all of that. So I just want people to really understand what they are selling out there is protection for little micro surges that come from within a structure, as well as like utility line surges, far distant lightning that interacts with the distribution system, the power poles, transmission lines. Those are the kind of things that it's protecting against, and it actually has a pretty low threshold, but it's just to try to ensure some kind of longevity, and any surges that do come in, it's gonna try to dampen them to minimize their effects. That's what these things do. So, hope you learned something. Love you crazy people. I'll see you in the next one.